Welcome to the Eastwood Tulsa podcast. My name is Jeremy Rhodes. Pastor Gordon, it's good to see you.
Good to see you too.
Glad that you're here. We've been, over the last many episodes now, been talking about the attributes of God, which has been incredible. You know, I've been going deeper into understanding all these various ways that God has revealed himself, who he is, all of these characteristics that govern who he is, if we can say it that way. And so it's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, I've learned a lot. As the communicator, I feel very humbled that I really don't know everything about these subjects.
Sure.
And I want to know God better, but that's the idea.
Yeah.
That we get to know him better and trust him more.
Yeah, absolutely. Last week, we started talking about the sovereignty of God.
Right.
Which this is probably one of the hardest things to, hardest attributes, because there's so much, you know, so much in the sovereignty of God. So we're going to kind of get into this a little bit more today, especially as it comes to evangelism. In the sovereignty of God. So we're really glad that you're with us. Hey, just as we begin here today, we want to invite you, if you've not subscribed to our podcast, we would love for you to do that. You can just hit the subscribe button there, and then that way you are joining us. We would love to hear your comments, feedback, questions that you have. Also, if these episodes have been a blessing to you, would you share those with those around you? Somebody that you know, hey, this guy person really needs to hear what they're talking about today and join in this discussion. We pray that these discussions are empowering you in your life, but also they're helping you to have other conversations with the people in your life about these particular truths. And so we're really glad you're with us today. A little later on, we want to share with you about some other things that we've started here at Eastwood, and we'll talk about that at the end of the program today.
Great.
About Right Now
Right.
Media.
Right.
But let's get back into this conversation, Pastor, about sovereignty, the sovereignty of God. And here is God, all-powerful. We talked about kind of where that the word sovereignty comes from, because it's really not mentioned in that light in the New Testament.
No, I think the word is only used one time in one translation of the Bible. So
right.
It's similar to the word Trinity, which doesn't appear in the Bible, but the truth is taught that God is three in one.
Right.
So God is in control.
Yes.
Yeah. He does have providence that he exercises. Mm-hmm. So some people like to talk about the providence of God and the sovereignty of God.
Sure.
At least in the same conversation.
Yes.
There's no such thing as luck. We talked about that last week. And so with salvation, it's so crucial. You know, does it depend upon God? Totally.
Right.
Are we responsible for sharing the gospel? Absolutely. So that's where we are in this podcast.
Well, you know, last week I was kind of tutoring a young man who's doing some speech and debate stuff, and part of his apologetics. And in his 6-minute speech that he was giving, he started using the word randomly. Well, you know, in apologetics, you really can't use this random term, which is the same way here when we talk about the sovereignty of God. There is nothing of luck or just random happenstance that happens. God is in control of all things.
Yeah, if we look at it, it may look like some things are random, but nothing is random for God. He's not saying, oops, or I didn't know that. He's in control of what's happening.
Yeah.
And that's hard because a lot of bad things happen.
Sure.
And you can't blame him for the bad things that happened, but you also can't say, well, he didn't have anything to say about what happened, because he did, even in his son's crucifixion.
Yeah.
Evil men carried it out, but he planned it.
Yeah. That is the truth.
That's a hard truth, but it's
true.
Those
are hard things. Yeah. But it's hard to grasp that. Because to kind of put that imagery there, it's like, is God this master, puppet master, you know, just kind of making all the puppets move and say and do things? That's kind of a big question, especially when we get into this aspect of evangelism. How do we share? Should we share? Why do we share our faith? Because if God's in control, then what, you know, obviously we have to have a role in this, or he would not give us commands like he does out of Matthew 28.
Right, and you lose motivation if you don't remember that Jesus commanded us
right.
to go into all the world and make disciples of all mm-hmm. the nations. So, and he said, all authority has been given to me. Mm. Go, therefore, and all those are imperatives, going, making disciples, baptizing. So it's not like it's an option for us
right.
to do that. So we do have a big role in that.
Yes.
And then if you fast forward a little bit to the book of Romans, it says no one's going to go unless they're called and sent, and no one's going to believe unless they know the name to call upon.
Right.
You know, they're not going to call on somebody they don't know.
Right.
So we are definitely involved
in that. Well, obviously that's been the thrust of every mission or missionary organization or person is that right there. We feel the calling to go, to be sent to people that have not heard, because if I don't share it, who's going to share it with them?
Right. And I remember I was in seminary years ago, and this question came up about people hearing the gospel, and they have to hear the gospel in
right.
order to be saved. And without giving you the whole story, basically someone just shot up in the middle of the discussion and said, well, they're not going to be there, you know, unless they hear about Jesus. And the professor was real good. He said, well, then you better go tell them. So in other words, if we really believe that people mm-hmm. are going to hell and they are going to hell without Christ every day, then we need to have
right.
that in our hearts, and we need to do whatever we can to make sure the gospel is proclaimed. At the same time, realize that God is sovereign over that process.
Right.
But I am definitely responsible.
Right.
So
really this aspect of where our conversation is going to go today with evangelism is that God is sovereign in all things. He is control of all things. If God can immediately tell you who's going to get saved and who's not going to get saved. I mean, because he's all knowing, you know, so that's not an issue with God, but it doesn't alleviate us from certain responsibilities that are already laid out in his word concerning evangelism and sharing.
Well, let's look at the two sides. Let's look at the witness mm-hmm. side and also the person that's receiving or hearing mm-hmm. the gospel. My understanding is that God doesn't look down through history and then see someone believing and then choose them.
Mm-hmm.
He's chosen them before the foundation of the world.
Right. Scripture says that.
Right. Scripture right. says that. So in our sharing of the gospel, he also knows who's going to go and share and be obedient to that calling. Mm-hmm. So it's not just that I don't have a role in obeying the command of Jesus. I most definitely have a role mm-hmm. in obeying. So I don't want to say, well, he knows who's going to share and who's going to come, so let him do that. No, that means I'm disobedient mm-hmm. to the call of God. So that's huge in my
right,
mind.
Right.
I want to obey him. And Jesus said, I only do what pleases the Father. I always do his will. So it's definitely his will that we go
right.
and that we share and that we make disciples. So you still have that tension, like you said,
right.
you know, about God knowing what's
right.
going to happen. There's a little bit more, as we know,
right.
to that whole scenario.
Right.
He knows, but he also has a purpose mm-hmm. in sending us.
Right.
Yeah. So
right.
we're still right back to,
we
to
are.
The tension that we
so,
have there.
So inside of this, because this is sometimes a big question that a lot of evangelicals pose, is if God is sovereign, then does man truly have free will?
Right.
You know, without getting into some of the rest of the debate, because I know there's a lot of
thank
people
thank you so
that,
much for asking
you
that
know,
question.
But it does in this. I mean, if I'm sharing the gospel with someone, because this I think leads to why believers don't always share is because they don't want to be rejected. When they do share, they want somebody to receive Christ,
right.
you know, and not that they would reject Christ or just think about it or whatever, but, you know, that we actually do it. So if someone rejects what I say, then, you know, it's kind of a downer for me. It's not really motivating
sure.
for me to get out and say it again to somebody else. So this whole this concept of free will is what really comes into play. So what role does my responsibility to obey God, but then free will of the individual, or is there free will that the individual employs in that?
Well, the simplistic answer is I'm not responsible for the response of the person that is hearing the gospel.
Right.
So if they reject my witness, if I'm doing it in the proper way, you know, I'm not obnoxious, I'm not a poor representation of Christ, then if I'm doing what is right and in the fullness of the Spirit, I'm not responsible for their rejection of the gospel. But I think you're asking a deeper question than that. The person that responds, I would go to a biblical illustration of Pharaoh.
Okay.
Pharaoh did not let the children of Israel go. God specifically said that he would harden Pharaoh's heart and they wouldn't. He wouldn't let them go. But in that story, he also hardens his own heart.
Right.
So I don't think that at the end of history, Pharaoh will ever say, well, the reason I didn't let them go was because it's your fault. I think Pharaoh would say, no, I did not want to let them go.
Sure.
So here you have Pharaoh doing what he wants to do, but you also have God making sure that his name is known throughout all the earth by allowing his heart to be hard, or as the Bible says, he specifically hardened it.
Right.
So in the book of Romans chapter 1, the Bible says, because God did not, people did not respond to him, he gave them over to what they wanted to
do. Right.
You know,
which
is not good. No, it is not good. Three times he said he gave them up, he gave them up, he gave them up. So what I would say is we are fully responsible for the decisions we make. Mm-hmm. And the idea of a totally free agent in the world where you can do whatever you want to do, we may need to come back to another podcast and look at that. Because I understand that concept, but sometimes I look at Judas. Was Judas totally free to do whatever he wanted to do?
Right.
Well, yeah, in a sense, he did whatever he wanted to do. Jesus said, what you do, do quickly.
Sure.
He had it all planned out. But it, the Bible also says that there were scriptures that prophesied what he would do.
Right.
You know, so we come back to that same dilemma right there. So
yeah, and there is even the scripture, I think it's in, it's either John 12 or John 13, after Jesus had washed the feet and talked about, you know, he took the sup or the little bit of bread and stuff, it says at that point, then Satan entered him. So at that point, is it Judas that's doing the whole thing, or is it Satan working through? There is a lot. So maybe we need to come back to that as another side point in this. But if it's not, if the onus of the responsibility to share is on the believer, on me, then how does God's sovereignty then work inside of me to share the gospel?
I think you have to go to purpose there, because God has a purpose in people from every tribe, tongue, people, and nation being saved. So they are going to be.
Right.
So when we share the gospel, we have the assurance to know that God is working in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. And I think we just, at that point, we have to be obedient to do that, which I don't think we're doing as a church, as a Eastwood Baptist Church. I think we can do way, way better in obeying the Great Commission and see people. I want to see people from every tribe, tongue, nation, and people group come to know ta, ethne, the technical term, all the nations, everybody. And I would like to see our church reflect that in salvation. But if we don't share the gospel, we know that as far as my responsibility, I'm not being responsible.
Right.
So my question would be, let me ask you, you're asking me. So if I say, well, they're going to be saved one way or the other, so if I don't do it, someone will do it. Mm-hmm. My question would be, then is that what God is doing? He's passing over disobedient Christians and only working with obedient ones?
Sure.
Or are there some people that are actually not hearing because I was not faithful?
Right.
That's really a tough question.
That's
the Ezekiel 3.
I would say there's the aspect that what Jesus talked about, he said, many are called, but few are chosen. And in that sense, it's not the chosen like we're talking about. I think that we all feel the call of evangelism. But it's what we do with it is how God then uses us in the middle of it. If I hear the call of evangelists like I know I'm supposed to, and then I get the prompting that the Holy Spirit's been talking to me, and someone, one particular person is very illuminated to my mind or to my focus.
God is drawing him.
God is drawing him, and he's talking to you to go share. And if I sit and say no, No, I don't want to do that. No, that's stupid. No, no, no. All of a sudden, I almost disqualify myself from being used of God in that moment because I refuse to work with the Spirit of God. You know, that's one thing that Paul said all the time. He said, I will not frustrate the grace of God in my life. I always want to be obedient to what the Spirit of God is saying.
I get that.
If I'm not working with the Spirit, if I'm not working with God in doing the call, then I'm not in the middle. I'm not in what God is doing.
Well, let me rephrase my question, make it harder for you.
Okay.
Don't you love that?
That's great.
Okay, Ezekiel, I believe it's 3. Mm-hmm. Ezekiel tells the watchman to warn the wicked man. Mm-hmm. If he doesn't warn the wicked man, he will die in his sins, and his blood, the blood of the wicked man, he would require of the watchman. Mm-hmm. But if he warns the wicked man and the wicked man doesn't turn, then the wicked man dies in his sins and he's responsible. I heard that as a young Christian, and that motivated me to go to a particular individual and actually warn them. I did that, and it was terrifying because what I said to this individual was almost like a, you know, you better receive this message. And they got very, very mad at me for doing that. Mm-hmm. But I felt that as a young believer, just reading that, you know, without any commentary. So what I'm asking you is, who's responsible for the person's otherwise, if I don't go, they don't hear, they don't hear, they don't receive, they don't receive, they miss Christ. Mm-hmm. You know, so who's responsible, me or God in that situation? And that's where I'm not really asking you to answer. That's
sure. It's more of a rhetorical.
It's more of a.
It definitely is
very
from,
difficult
from a self-reflection standpoint. Obviously, individually, I would have to say, you know, if God is the one calling me and I'm being disobedient, then the responsibility is on me. Now, God could be calling multiple people to that. I don't know. I don't know what their experience is. But I would say if God is directing, is dealing with me about doing something where he is already at work and I'm refusing to join him, the responsibility of that is me. I'm the disobedient child.
Right. I get that.
You know, on the other side, God is still at work. So is God still at work saving those people even though I'm not being a willing participant with him? Then yes, he is.
And so then you're kind of getting around.
Well, no, then the fault still comes back to him. I mean, Jesus said, listen, you're not judged because, you know, I'm not here to judge the world. The word is already there. If you have not received it, then or you're unwilling to receive it, you are not going to, you're judged already. You're condemned already. So from that aspect, it doesn't, you know, at the end of the day, God's not going to be the one to blame.
No, and I would agree
you know.
With you. Maybe another podcast
right.
to talk about that. My heart is obviously for people that have not heard the gospel.
Right.
You know, the one-liner is, why should people have 25 or 50 chances to hear the gospel in the United States when some people have never had one opportunity?
Right.
So the one that has not heard are still responsible.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so that's a difficult more difficult.
Because obviously when it comes to salvation, the whole issue is sin.
Right.
Sin is the that is the whole issue. My sin is what's before God. My sin is what separates from God. Christ is the only one that came to solve the sin problem. If I don't put my trust and belief in him, I still have a sin problem. My sin is still against me.
Right.
So God is then justified in any condemnation that he gives because of sin.
Right, I know.
I know that you know that.
Argument.
But I'm saying that's the thing that we've got to stay in thinking of, is that that's the issue. But we have the good news to share that Jesus has come. There is a way where your sin no longer has to be against you. You know, he wants to take it from you. He's already died for it. Would you accept him? So then that solves the sin question between you and God. And then obviously belief in Christ changes it.
The questioner.
That's good. That's good. But this is something that I think all of us need in our life, where we are asking these questions and having these discussions with other believers, especially over an issue like this and sovereignty, where I'm trying to figure out, am I supposed to do something or am I not supposed to do something?
Yeah, and we just need to obey the call that we have as believers, or we are disobedient to our our Father that we say that we love, or our Savior that we say we believe in.
Absolutely.
So it's huge.
Yeah. So really, to kind of summate the end of it there, kind of the takeaways we have from evangelism is, one, we're called to go. I don't care who we are
right.
called to go. You mentioned the fact that we're not the one, it's not our responsibility how somebody else
responds. How they respond to the message, mm-hmm. right. We should be praying. We didn't bring up the fact mm-hmm. that Paul said, you know, my heart's desire and prayer to God for mm-hmm. Israel is that they might be saved. They have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and then in chapter 10, he says the same thing about, mm-hmm. well, in one of those, I can't remember where it's 9 or 10, he says, I would be cut off from Christ. Basically, I'll forfeit my going to heaven if they can have it.
Right.
You know, and Moses said a similar thing. So it's not that you don't have passion. It's not that you don't pray. It's not that you don't tell. You know, it's not you don't sit
right.
back. There is a definite part in our part. You know,
right.
And prayer, we're going to talk more next week.
Our next episode is going to be about prayer and the sovereignty of God, because there's a lot of questions about that.
Yeah.
I prayed for something. Do I pray according to God's will? If I'm praying and asking something that's not God's will, I mean, there's a lot in that. But just to re-encourage people, sharing, you got to share. You're not responsible for how somebody else responds to it. Obviously, you need to be wise in how you share. He that winneth souls is wise. Use wisdom in how you share. But the fact is, God wants... I mean, it's clear in Scripture. He says, it's not my will that any should perish, but that all would come to repentance. Unfortunately, not all will do that.
No, Jesus said the way is narrow and few find it.
Yeah. But it's our job to continue to share, you know, knowing that He is at work in people's lives and He is still wooing them. The Holy Spirit is working, and we've got to trust in that.
I think that's well said.
Yeah, we got to trust in that. There is one quote that you brought to me from Warren Wiersbe that we should mention. And it says, no one will deny that there are many mysteries connected with divine sovereignty and human responsibility, everything we've just talked about. Nowhere does God ask you to choose between these two truths, because they both come from God and are a part of His plan. They do not compete. They cooperate.
Right.
And that's one thing we need to really think about. It's the fact that human responsibility and God's sovereignty, they work together.
Yeah.
It's not against each other.
Yeah, and we didn't bring up some of the really heated debates that come here. But
yeah.
I think we'd all agree that we need to share Jesus.
Yes.
We need to share the gospel. We need to go to the nations. And God is sovereign in mm-hmm. that whole process.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely. Today, if you're thinking of someone in your own life that you need to go and you need to share with, do that. If right now that person has come to mind, that's the Holy Spirit prompting you. You need to be obedient to what God is saying, even if it's right now just stopping and praying for that person and then praying for a door of opportunity, a time that you can share with them. Do that. That's the first step. Next week, we're going to talk more about prayer and the sovereignty of God. But if you have a prayer request, we would love to pray with you about things that are concerning your life, situations that are affecting you right now. And you can simply send that prayer request to us by email at eastwood@eastwoodtulsa.org. You can also go on our website, which is eastwoodtulsa.org, and leave that there. We would love to be praying for you. Pastor, we've been receiving a lot of prayer requests lately.
We have, more than normal.
Continuing to pray over those that God's will, which is His sovereignty, but that His will is done in your life. That's the way Jesus taught us to pray. And so we're continuing to lift those up. But if you have one, we're committed to pray for you. So we thank you again for joining us next week about prayer and the sovereignty of God. And we hope that this conversation is helping you as we take the truths of Sunday into every day. Thank you. See you next time.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening to the Eastwood Tulsa podcast. Please leave us a comment or a question, like our podcast, and share it with your friends and family. Also, don't forget to subscribe so you never miss an episode. Finally, we'd like to invite you to join us online at eastwoodtulsa.org or Facebook Live at 11 a.m. every Sunday morning. Or join us in person at 948 South 91st East Avenue in Tulsa at 10:45 a.m. Once again, thanks for listening to the Eastwood Tulsa podcast, bringing the truths of Sunday into every day.